I went to the University of Leeds and I studied geography. I studied geography because it was one of the subjects I took at school. It again had diverse content. It was about the world and the people in it. And while studying geography at the University of Leeds, I read a paper on Lourdes, the shrine in France. And it was about the trainloads of people that were going there and the hotels that had been built to accommodate them while they went to this Catholic shrine. And I related that to the seaside resorts in the United Kingdom that I'd visited with my parents. And I realized that it was something one could study and learn about. And that's how my interest in tourism was first sparked. There was a delay before I really got the opportunity to work further on tourism. I did that when I went to Toronto. And there, I worked historically on tourism. I have found some historical geographers who were very encouraging. They said, nobody's done any work like this. One of the things that attracts me about tourism is its breadth and its relationships with economy, with culture, with the arts. It allows one to be to read very broadly. I've been studying tourism for probably 50 years, 40 years being paid for doing so in universities. And I don't have all the answers to the questions. They change. I've had the opportunity to work internationally. And I think that's been very important, because when you engage with another location, another culture, you reflect upon your own. You're encouraged to ask, you're encouraged to ask different questions, or sometimes the answers to the same questions are different. So there's a lot of learning to take place. So I think that having narrowed itself to focus on narrowly on tourism, I think to get greater respect for tourism research, it has to broaden again. Because in order to get respect from people in other fields, you have to engage with them and you have to persuade them that you have something to offer. In my career, I've been able to make some contributions regarding particularly impacts of tourism and their implications for planning over quite a considerable time. After I came to Canada, a book which I wrote called Tourism, Economic, Physical and Social Impacts, actually written with one of my graduate students, Alistair Matheson, has proved to be quite successful and quite important in my own career. It was written at a time when most material had a business or marketing orientation. This particular book has much more than that. It covers environmental impacts, it covers sociocultural impacts, it makes reference to things like dance and music, and some people have very kindly said that it was one of the first books to in fact move from a business perspective to a broader academic perspective. More recently, I should say that book went through 19 printings with no changes. So that means it deals mostly with ideas and concepts which gets outdated much less quickly than tables and data. I describe myself as an academic, although one thing that has been important is that I have had the opportunity to be engaged in many practical planning experiences, particularly in Asia, but also in North America, and at all scales, from national, even international, down to state and province and local levels. And I think that that tries to keep one real, keeps one ideas grounded, and it allows one to be more critical about some of what I regard as superficial statements in the literature. I never expected to work in Asia. It's a big surprise, but I had the opportunity to do some work in Bali and Indonesia at the time that sustainable development just became a new buzzword. And the project that I was involved in there was, I think, one of the first major projects which tried to implement the concepts of sustainable development, done with colleagues and done with graduate students to work in China. And so for much of my career, as I've said, unexpectedly, I've had the opportunity to work in Asia, particularly Indonesia and China, including Taiwan.